Welcome to Concordia Church Online. My name is Melissa Salomon. I'm the Community Life Coordinator here at Concordia, and it's my delight and pleasure to welcome you. We are in a new message series on the Book of Acts, Learning to Follow Jesus. We're glad that you're here. The message will follow soon, but first, let's worship together.
Hi, my name is Richard. I'm the pastor here at Concordia. Some of you, it's the first time that you're tuning in, so I wanted to take a moment to introduce myself. We're spending some time looking at stories of the first followers of Jesus, things that really happened, so that we can learn from them what it means to follow Jesus, both as people and as churches. Thanks for being here for a part of that today. If you're one of those whose heart is moved to give, you know, that's because God's moving your heart. We believe that we don't give because we want God to give us something. We believe God's already given us everything. And one of the ways that we respond to him is by giving back. I want to encourage you to give where your heart is. If you've been connecting here at Concordia, a good way to give is online or through our app. If your heart is in a different place, then give there. Follow your heart and let your heart lead you into generosity, because that's close to God. As this series connects with you, I also want to encourage you to jump in on the Zoom group. Click on our website on the spot where it says Zoom groups, and that'll help you get connected into a further discussion. They'll be starting up a week from this week, and it's a way that you connect with people during the week about the things that we're going to be talking about today. Thanks for being here. Let's start our time together with singing. Thank you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Let us pray.
Lord of all power and might, of author and giver of all good things, instill in our hearts the love of your name. Impress on our minds the teachings of your word, and increase in our lives all that is holy and just. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
As Christians, it's important to remember that our relationship is not just with me and Jesus, not just with me and God, that there are other believers that God calls the body of Christ. Not only do we support each other and care for each other, but we hold a faith in common. Each week we express that faith using the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Jesus. It seems fairly obvious, doesn't it, that people and churches learning to follow Jesus would be Jesus-centered. I mean, if we want to follow Jesus, that is, it seems obvious that Jesus is the center of what we believe, that Jesus is the center of who we are, that Jesus is the center of how we live. At least he should be, right? If we're following Jesus and not our own course. Jesus-centered means that everything starts with Jesus, and everything comes back to Jesus, and every solution is ultimately Jesus. Okay, the world right now is, well, it's full of darkness and bitterness and divisiveness and arrogance and anger and hate and chaos and crisis and catastrophe and on multiple levels and in multiple places, and it seems in 2020 that's just kind of piling up all over the place. But people in churches who follow Jesus believe because We've read it, we've seen it, we've experienced it. We believe that Jesus brings light into the darkness and peace into the chaos. We believe, if you follow Jesus, that there's hope and healing in Jesus' name. We believe that there's reconciliation and restoration in Jesus' name. We believe that there's forgiveness and fresh starts in Jesus' name. We believe that there's promises and possibilities in Jesus' name. And if you follow Jesus, you believe that Jesus offers all those things, even in a world of turmoil and chaos. Even in a world where you want answers and all you seem to find is more questions. Even a world like where this year for a whole lot of people, your personal world has been turned upside down maybe multiple times. Even in that sort of a world, we believe, if you follow Jesus, that Jesus is here and that Jesus will see you through. So if that's what we believe, why is it so hard to stay Jesus-centered? What makes it so hard to stay Jesus-centered? Probably, I think, in part it's because life is messy. And probably in part it's because we're easily distracted. And probably in part it's because we are by nature sort of self-centered. And all those things kind of pull us off track and off center. And you know what? Jesus' first followers, they had the same issue. Their life was messy. They were easily distracted. And they had the same self-centered nature that we do. But as we dig into their stories, what we find is that they kind of found a way through that. They found a way to stay Jesus-centered, or if they got off track, to get back. So we're going to dig into their stories and look today at what being Jesus-centered means and the difference that living Jesus-centered lives makes in a world that's a little bit messed up. Now, when you read through the book of Acts, there's a lot of different summaries of things that Jesus' friends said to other people. We might call it preaching, okay? Now, the pattern of their preaching goes something like this. Some event happens. Usually it's something that people aren't expecting, like Acts chapter 2, these tongues of fire and this loud wind in them speaking in other languages, or what we're going to see today in Acts chapter 3, this miraculous healing. And then people wonder about it. And that gives Jesus' friends an opportunity to talk about it. But here's the interesting thing about their preaching. While part of what they have to say deals with that specific event, the harder their message never stays there. Never stays on that one single event, or their part in it, actually. It keeps coming back to Jesus. It keeps coming back to Jesus, and with some variations, it sounds a lot like this.
No other king could vanquish the war horse or silence the warrior's rage while riding the lowly back of a donkey. No other king could break the dominion of darkness, the tyranny of evil, with a reign of grace and a kingdom of peace. No other king could give his life for the redemption of rebels, his wealth to welcome the outcast. Jesus is that king, the king of glory, son of the living God. Not just another king, not just another prophet, not just another teacher. He was the one the world had been waiting for. The one to deliver us from captivity, the son of David and Abraham's chosen seed. He is the goal of the Mosaic law, Yahweh in the flesh. He is the one to establish God's reign and rule, to heal the sick, give sight to the blind, freedom to the prisoners, and proclaim good news to the poor. This Jesus was the creator come to earth and the beginning of a new creation. He embodied the covenant, fulfilled the commandments, and reversed the curse. spoke of to the serpent, the one prefigured to Noah in the flood, the one promised to Abraham, the one guaranteed to Moses before he died, the one promised to David during his reign, the one revealed to Isaiah as a suffering servant, the one predicted through the prophets and prepared for through John the Baptist. He is the Father's Son, Savior of the world, and substitute for our sins. More loving, more holy, and more wonderfully terrifying than we ever thought possible. He is our Jesus, and there is no other King like Him. He is our God, our glory, our victorious Savior. There is no other King like Him. There is no other King.
So every single one of their messages that they're talking with other people is Jesus-centered. And the heart, the core, the center of that message is Jesus crucified, risen, and victorious. Let me give you a sample from the parts of the book that we're in right now, Acts chapter 2, verse 23 and 24. You crucified Jesus, there's crucified Jesus, who was given over to death by a plan God had determined in advance, but God brought him back from death to life and destroyed the pains of death because death had no power to hold him. What do you hear there? Crucified, risen, victorious Jesus. Chapter 3, verse 17 to 19. Now, fellow Israelites, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did your leaders, but this is how God fulfilled what he had foretold through all the prophets, saying that his Messiah would suffer. Repent then and turn to God so that your sins may be wiped out, that times of refreshing may come from the Lord. Again, crucified, risen, victorious Jesus, who, and here's where they always go, who forgives your sins and helps you start fresh. So turn to him and change the way you think and change the way you act and believe in Jesus, because he's where true help and true healing and true hope is found. Crucified, risen, victorious Jesus. That is always, always, always the center they're preaching. Now, here's why that's so important in a messed up world like the one that we live in. See, crucified, risen, victorious Jesus means that, yeah, Satan is strong, but Jesus is stronger. It means that, yeah, life is full of trouble, but that Jesus actually overcomes troubles in the end. It means that, yeah, life is hard, but because Jesus is alive, you are never alone. And it means, yeah, death is hard, really hard, and it seems so final. But it's not, because Jesus, who died, is still alive. Jesus lives. Now, let's dig a little deeper into those truths. Let me start with that last one. Death hurts. Now, here at Concordia, well, we certainly felt that this week. Our friend Aaron died rather suddenly. And you don't think about that a person with cancer dies rather suddenly. But he did. Aaron was just vibrant. Alive, knew everybody's name, knew everybody's story, just filled the room with life and personality. He's 51. I mean, that's a big void at Concordia. It's a bigger void in his family. How do you get through that? How do you get through a loss like that, especially since no matter how big the personalities are, how great the memories are, how big the legacy is, they fade with the passing of time. How do you get through? Crucified, risen, victorious Jesus. See, crucified, risen, victorious Jesus means that death is not as final as it feels. Let me take you back to Acts chapter 2 again. Acts chapter 2, verse 24, God brought him, that's Jesus, back from death back to life and destroyed the pains of death because death had no power to hold him. Jesus destroyed the pains of death. What that means is, yeah, there's grief. But even in grief, there's still hope. It's a sure and a certain hope based not on what Aaron did or how good a person Aaron was or how many lives he impacted or any other number of wonderful things that he did or was. It's a hope based on Jesus, the eternal one, the crucified, risen, victorious Jesus and what he did for us and what he freely gives to us. Acts chapter 4, verse 12, a little later in the story, no one else can save us. Indeed, we can be saved only by the power of the one named Jesus and not by any other person. What that's saying is that hope in death is found in the crucified, risen, and victorious Jesus who went to death and lived to tell about it. Who died and lived to tell about it. Yeah, Satan is strong, but Jesus is stronger. And yeah, death hurts, but because of Jesus, it is not the end. The Jesus who died still lives today. And that means that there's hope for Aaron. Because, see, Aaron believed in Jesus. And because Jesus lives, Aaron lives too. And that means there's hope for Aaron's family. Because Jesus who lives is also a man acquainted with sorrows, familiar with suffering, familiar with grief. He's gone through more pains than any of us have. And he lives to be there with them and for them. And it means there's hope for us. Because every single one of us have to go through these pains of death. Often many times in life. And what would it be like to go through that without any hope? It'd be awful, wouldn't it? Being Jesus-centered in your faith really matters. And here's the other place it matters. Not just like in this tragic and untimely death of my friend Aaron. It also matters for facing all of life's problems. All of them, but especially like the complicated and confusing ones and the ones that are sometimes seeming like impossible or unsolvable or insurmountable. Let me take you back into the story, Acts chapter 3. Peter and John were going to the temple courtyard for the 3 o'clock prayer. At the same time, a man who had been lame from birth was carried by some men. Every day, these men would put the lame man at a gate in the temple courtyard. The gate was called Beautiful Gate. There he would beg for handouts from people going into the courtyard. When the man saw that Peter and John were about to go into the courtyard, he asked them for a handout. Peter and John stared at him. "Look at us," Peter said. So the man watched them closely. He expected to receive something from them. However, Peter said to him, "I don't have any money, but I'll give you what I do have. Through the power of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk." Peter took hold of the man's right hand and began to help him up. Immediately, the man's feet and ankles became strong. Springing to his feet, he stood up and started to walk. And then this little footnote way at the end of chapter 4, as this story plays out, the man who was healed by this miracle was over 40 years old. Right? Now, this guy had a major issue, okay? He was paralyzed from birth. Couldn't walk from birth. Had never been able to walk. And this issue had been going on for 40 years. Medical science wasn't able to solve it. No one was able to solve it. And his hope, in this impossible and improbable situation was just like, hey, can I get enough of a handout to make it through the day? Not much of a hope, is it? Enter these Jesus-centered guys, Peter and John. They don't give him money. What do? They solve his unsolvable problem. They do what's been impossible for 40 years. In the name of Jesus, they heal him. In the name of Jesus, they heal him. And as the story plays out in the rest of Acts 3 and 4, they made it clear that they weren't the ones solving the problem. Okay, that it was Jesus who was solving the problem. Peter and John make it very clear that Jesus is the source of the healing, that Jesus is the source of the miracle, that Jesus is the reason this guy who couldn't walk is now leaping and walking and jumping for joy in the temple, that Jesus is the one who solved his unsolvable problem. Now, that does raise some questions and issues, some of which I can't really answer or explain. I can't answer why is it that some people, like this guy, are healed while we're praying for them, and others while we're praying for them, and we're all praying together, and we're intensely praying for something, that they get that ultimate healing of heaven much sooner than anybody wants it to be. I guess we just have to kind of trust our Heavenly Father on that one. But here's what I do see in this event and others like it in the book of Acts and what it shows. I think it again reemphasizes what I said at the beginning, that while Satan's strong, Jesus is stronger. If you've been with me through some of these series, we talked a little few weeks ago about how Satan His plan is to destroy everything that he can, to wreck God's world, to wreck God's people, to steal, kill, and destroy, to pile on despair and discouragement and depression, to get people at each other and to sow evil all over the place. And you know what? He's doing a pretty good job of it, isn't he? This particular year, he certainly seems to be advancing. And there are all sorts of seemingly impossible, insurmountable problems. And I look back here, and I remember that Jesus is stronger. I mean, that's a Jesus-centered faith. To say that Satan is strong, but Jesus is stronger. To say, yeah, life is full of trouble, and don't we know it in 2020, but that Jesus can overcome our troubles. Even the complicated and impossible and insurmountable ones. Jesus can solve life's problems. All right, it's kind of easy to forget that when problems just keep piling and piling and piling up like they are this year. But the crucified, risen, and victorious Jesus, the center of this Jesus-centered faith, the crucified, risen, and victorious Jesus reminds us that Satan's strong, but Jesus is stronger. That life's full of trouble, but Jesus overcomes those troubles. That even when everything else fails, Jesus doesn't. Okay, that's Jesus, what Jesus-centered people believe. So here's what I want you to do right now. In this particular time when it's so easy, even for people who believe in Jesus, to get off Jesus-centered. What I want you to do is, in this crazy year, in this crazy time, just hit pause. Hit pause for a moment and reflect on this. If you're watching and listening with somebody else, maybe spend some time talking about it as well. Reflect on what are the major problems that you're facing right now? Okay, what are the major problems that you're facing right now? And where are you struggling to find a solution? And then, before you come back to this message, I want you to pray about it. I want you to ask Jesus for help. That's what a Jesus-centered faith does. Okay, so we got a good handle on what it means to have a Jesus-centered faith. But how does being Jesus-centered play out in everyday life? There's a few things I notice in this part of the story from the early followers of Jesus. The first thing I see there is that Jesus gets the credit for the good stuff. Jesus gets the credit for the good stuff. And you know, it's just kind of the opposite of the way we are kind of wired to look at things. In the bad stuff, it's like, well, why God? Why? Why Jesus? Why did you let this happen? Or why don't you do something? And in the good stuff, it's usually, well, yeah, of course, I did this. I earned this. I deserve this. Acts 3 and 4, Peter and John give all the credit. All the credit, 110% of the credit for the healing miracle to Jesus. All right, now, as the people are gathering for this miracle, Peter and John are probably also, cheering, yay, God, along with them, because they understand that Jesus is the source of the miracle. But it would have been also really natural for them to get kind of caught up in the moment, all right? We do love the crowd. We love the crowd, we love the stage, we love the attention, we love the spotlight, don't we? And feeding off the energy of the crowd and taking in the advantage of the moment, it would have been pretty natural for the story to kind of play out something like this. Oh yeah, of course, yeah, all glory to God. All glory to God. God gets the credit because we know he gave the power to do it. But look who he's using. Look who he's using, That's us, right? Us, Peter and John, those guys who were fishermen, looks like we hit the big time. And it's like, can you feel the love? Can I feel the love of the crowd? And it would have been so easy and natural, and that's not what happens. Might have been that way if it was me in the story. Let me read you some of the things that they say several different times. Acts chapter 3, verse 16. We believe in the one named Jesus. Through his power alone, this man whom you know was healed, as all of you saw. Acts 4, verse 10. Let me clearly state to you and all the people of Israel that he was healed by the powerful name of Jesus Christ the Nazarene, the man you crucified, but who God raised from the dead. Heard this one before. No one else can save us. Indeed, we can be saved by no power, only by the power of the one named Jesus, and not by any other person. And then near the end of the chapter, we'll come back to this one. So they called the apostles back in and commanded them never to speak or teach in the name of Jesus. But Peter and John replied, "Do you think God wants us to obey you rather than him? We cannot stop telling about everything we have seen and heard." Jesus, 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 Jesus. There is not us anywhere in there. Seems like Peter and John are starting to learn that Jesus-centered people talk about Jesus. And that people who are learning to follow Jesus stay Jesus-centered. And that churches who are learning to follow Jesus stay Jesus-centered. And you know, I think that is such a challenge. It really is. Not only because the world is messy and because we're easily distracted, but I think maybe especially because we are by nature quite self-centered. And that is a problem. Here's how I see that place out sometimes in church world, and maybe even closer to home in pastor world. Right? That's if I or if we want to do great things for God, all right, and I'm actually seeking God and I'm praying and I'm working hard and I'm following God's lead and God's direction, so I know that I'm doing what God wants me to do in the place that he wants me to do it, with the people he wants me to doing it with, and with the best of the ability he's given me, but I'm doing all that and I look around and I'm kind of disappointed with the results. I bet there's probably a little bit of pride at work. What I'm saying, maybe even feeling this is for God, but we do love the stage, don't we? We love the stage, we love the crowd, we love the spotlight, we love the pat on the back. And there is this sinister, self-centered part of me that probably wants God to work in me and through me so that I am noticed, so that I'm honored, so that I am glorified, so that I get my name in church journals, so that I get the credit for creative thinking and new ministry initiatives and the ground that I'm plowing for people that are going to follow, so that someone listens to me, so maybe even seeks my advice or tries to imitate what I was doing, right? I want to see that. My friend and I used to joke about, hey, maybe we ought to start the mini church conference. You know, there's all these mega church conferences, and we ought to start the mini church conference. But, you know, who would know about it? And who would come? You got all this, well, poor me, this small-sized or mid-sized church that nobody knows about or cares about. And when that starts creeping into our thinking, if that's what's in my heart, am I Jesus-centered or am I me-centered? And if I'm not liking the results that God's giving, were the results that I was after for God, or were they more for me? Right, here's where the Apostle Paul came down on that one. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 2. I resolved to know nothing but Jesus Christ and Him crucified. I resolved to know nothing but Jesus Christ and Him crucified. Now, in our on-site worship on Sunday here in Concordia's campus, we're going to trace through some of Paul's thinking on that. If you're not able to join us in person, that's really a valuable thing to look at. So I'm going to put those verses up for you on the screen right now. Okay. So the first thing that being Jesus-centered looks like in a very practical, day-to-day living place is that Jesus gets the credit for the good stuff. The second very practical thing that Jesus-centered looks like in our lives is that we make it a practice to do good in Jesus' name. Make it a practice, a habit, a conscious effort, something that we're doing a lot, that we're looking for these opportunities to do good. I mean, like Peter and John, they saw this guy. Instead of just zipping by to worship, they actually saw the opportunity and they did something about it. Okay, the opportunity is for us to, as we're walking through daily life, how do we see the good that needs to be done? How do we see whether we have the ability to do something about it? And then how do we do something about it? And you know what? In this culture, that probably provides more opportunities to share Jesus than anything we might tweet or post. You see, people today find it pretty easy to either ignore or even to rail against ideas that they're opposed to. But even today, it's pretty hard to pick a fight with doing good. In fact, doing good might be one of the best ways to invite a culture that really doesn't care about Jesus to consider Jesus. Back to Acts 3 and 4. Now here's what's going on as you read through that for yourselves. The Jewish authorities are not exactly jazzed that these guys, Peter and John, are preaching about this Jesus that they had crucified and saying he's alive and saying, by the way, we're doing all these miracles in his name. They're irritated that that's happening, and they're irritated that the people are taking notice. The beginning of chapter 4 says the church has grown from 3,000 to 5,000. This Jesus-centered stuff, it was a threat. And so what they did is they had Peter and John arrested, and they threw them into prison overnight, and then they hauled them in the next morning for this little trial thing. And I'm going to read you a little bit of their, quote, defense of themselves. Down in verse 9, if we are being examined today concerning a good deed done to a crippled man. Okay, That's their opening statement. If we're being examined for a good deed done to a crippled man, in other words, there's not really any, Peter and John don't have any real defense. They're simply pointed out, hey, we did some good. Wasn't it good what we did? The evidence is there. There's this guy who wasn't able to walk for 40 years and now he's walking. What's wrong with that? Focusing on doing good. That's what living a Jesus-centered life looks like. And you know what? That's something that we can do. That's something that we can do because you see, in our self-absorbed and skeptical culture, the miracle experience that kind of gets people's attention is often something like a good deed where it's unexpected, a kind word where it's unexpected, a soft or gentle word or even silence in response to anger, forgiveness that brings healing to a relationship. And don't miss this, in this polarized world, it's also treating people with decency and respect, even when, maybe especially when their worldview is way different than mine. It's listening to someone who thinks or votes totally differently than I do, or who has a totally different moral or theological viewpoint. It's showing kindness and talking graciously both online and in person, even with people who think way differently than I do and who'd rather that my opinions and values didn't even exist. That's the miracle that opens doors for people considering Jesus in these days, just actually like back then. Check out how this particular confrontation ends. I told you we'd come back here, chapter 4, beginning at verse 18. So they called the apostles back in and commanded them never again to speak or teach in the name of Jesus. But Peter and John replied, "Do you think God wants us to obey you rather than him? We cannot stop telling about everything we've seen and heard." First, notice what Peter and John didn't do. They didn't strike back. They didn't trash talk. Didn't condemn the condemners. Didn't like hold signs or make a protest or spit venom. They didn't clobber people over the head. They didn't go viral with their own crowd and about how terrible these people were. In short, they were just being a lot like Jesus. They were responding with hate with love. They were responding to anger with kindness. They were responding to injustice with humility. That's a Jesus-centered life. Jesus-centered not just in what they said, but in how they lived and in how they loved. And get this, in how they loved people of the opposition party who were trying to make their life miserable. And get this, also make the life miserable of those people they were hanging around with. Paul, who became a follower of Jesus after first opposing him, put it this way. It's Romans chapter 12, verse 21. Not a bad one to memorize. Do not overcome evil with evil, but overcome evil with good. Do not overcome evil with evil, but overcome evil with good. All right, a Jesus-centered faith leads to a Jesus-centered life. And a Jesus-centered life means doing good, even, maybe, even especially for the people who are different than you. A Jesus-centered life means living graciously, even maybe especially with the people who are different than you. A Jesus-centered life means sharing grace, maybe especially for people who are different than you. So what I want you to do is you leave this message is just to reflect on that this week. Jesus-centered life is doing good, is living graciously, is sharing grace. reflect on that and figure out one way to do one of those things this week. To do good for people who are different than you are. To live graciously with people who think differently than you do. To share grace with people who normally nobody wants anything to do with. That's a Jesus-centered life. Let us pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. We began our worship gathering in God's name. We end our worship time together leaving with God's blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Our worship together concludes today by the singing of a final hymn.
We're glad you joined us today for Church Online. If you're here for the first time, we'd love to welcome you. Please send a text with the word new to this number, 619-493-4001. We'd also love to pray with you. Please send a text with the word prayer to the same number, 619-493-4001, and you'll get a link where you can write your prayer need. And we'll get right on it.